We can start.
Yeah, you start, sir.
Okay, sir.
Okay, good evening to all and welcome to our examinees. First of all, are the Jayasekhar Mohan from the KS Sanjay Medical College, Bangalore, and Anil Kumar, HOD, Government Medical College, Alappuzha, and Dr. Binny John, Unit Chief, Government Medical Kottayam, and Dr. Salim Mohammed, Assistant Medical Kollam. These are today's eminent examiners and eminent surgeons. And I also welcome our veteran, none other than Dr. Dayanandabab sir and P. Ryan sir. Both are evaluating these sessions. Finally, they conclude the session. That is the end of our program. And I also welcome all the students, participants, DNB and MS students from the entire Kerala. And also welcome our presenter, Dr. Meera Murali.
She's
the final year AR, Government Medical College, Periyar. Government Medical College, Periyar. And before starting, once more, I welcome to all the examiners and the students and presenter and then boss and Ryan sir. The examiners can talk anything more. You can utilize a few minutes.
Good evening, everybody. This is, I think, thanks to the effort taken by ASA. Last year, we all had a quasi clinic system pioneered by the ASA team members like Binny, Secretary of the Year, and the President, Dr. R.C. Shikumar. They have pioneered by conducting so many quasi clinics, but this year we had a different system because of the COVID scenario also, as a webinar, but then this is very well organized. And I think every session should stand out distinctly. Week after week, it's getting improved. So today I thought we will have little introductory chat by one of the examiners. I will not be stealing much time of the presenter or of the questionnaire session. But then we have been fortunate enough in getting two legendary teachers and sit with them. One among them, Dr. Dayanandabab sir himself, is my own HOD for some time. And so with P. Rajan sir, and the us in Malayalam master saying goes on, like that, Dr. Gobi sir from Calicut Government Medical College happened to be our chair, organizing it with much more exemplary, superb, enthusiastic organizing skill. Last session I have attended, my own PG was appearing. And as an introductory remark, I am taken back to a scenario of 30, 35 years back when I just completed my MS and I was a very junior faculty, very enthusiastic to take class. I was blessed by some of the very senior persons of the department giving me permission to have classes of the final year MBBS students as an evening class occasionally at once or twice per week. And it happened, there was a gathering of 25 students at an evening where I was asking a very tricky question regarding this own topic, today's own topic, varicose. And one of the most unassuming guy from the gathering, all of them failed to answer that question. That was a little tricky. Meera, this tricky question will be facing you in the long run, probably in this session also, though it is not very pertinent as was given in the recent advance of that time. Very unassuming, very quiet chap came forward with hesitation to give an answer, and that answer was superb. That was the answer. And that guy, I am happy to announce that guy is today with me as a vascular surgeon, Dr. Binny John, who was my own UG student, who could answer when nobody else could answer. So this question, if our presenter is answering, definitely, I hope with God's grace, tomorrow she may also, God alone knows where she will be standing. Probably she will become a renowned vascular surgeon. With this introductory chat to bring you up as a candidate, don't to depress you. I don't want to have, my own beloved great teacher, Matthew Roy sir, used to say there are two methods of teaching. One is by depressing, one is by encouraging, and sir was believing in him. So by encouraging comments, we would like to bring up our candidate, to perform maximum as the super presentation. Dr. Meera, over to the chairman to guide and to have the session monitored and guided.
Okay, we will start the session. I am welcome, Meera. We can proceed with your presentation.
Okay, sir. Meera. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
You are audible and okay, audible.
Shall I start?
Okay, you can start.
I'm Dr. Meera Murali, JR3 Department of General Surgery, Government Medical College, Kannur, and I'll be presenting the case of a 62-year-old gentleman who is hailing from Mail, Kannur. He is a tea seller by profession and belonging to a low socioeconomic class. He came with chief complaints of dilated tortuous veins, which he noticed in both his legs since the past 5 years. Pain and edema in the lower part of his left leg since the last 2 years, and discoloration and itching in the lower part of left leg since last 1 year. Coming to the history of presenting illness, the patient gave history of dilated tortuous veins, which he noticed to form on both his legs since the past 5 years. It was insidious in onset, progressive in nature, and it is more on his left leg. He first noticed it in the inner aspect of the left lower leg, and it gradually progressed upwards. It becomes more prominent on prolonged standing and also by the end of the day, and it reduces on lying down. He also has pain and edema in the lower part of his left leg since the last 2 years. It is mild, the pain is mild, intermittent aching type, and it is more in the ankle and foot region. It is more prominent on prolonged standing and it gets relieved by lying down. There is no history of claudication pain or rest pain. He also gave history of hyperpigmentation and itching in the lower part of his left leg since the past 1 year. There's no history of fever or ulceration, no history of pain or swelling in the calf area. There's no history suggestive of any prolonged immobilization or trauma, no history of breathing difficulty, chest pain, cough or hemoptysis, or abdominal distension, any abdominal swellings or chronic constipation. Coming to the past history, he has no non-comorbidities, and there is no history of any surgeries in the past or any drug intake, no history of any prolonged hospitalization. He has been using compression stockings for his complaints since the last 3 years, but he is not compliant with it. Coming to the personal history, he is on mixed diet. Bowel and bladder habits are normal. There is no addictions are there. He is a tea seller and hence has to stand for long hours at his shop. He also have a family history of varicose vein in his younger brother, who is age 56 and who underwent a surgical intervention on his right leg for the same 3 years back. Coming to the summary, a 62-year-old male who is working as a tea seller with no non-comorbidities came with complaints of dilated tortuous veins on bilateral legs, which he noticed for the past 5 years, and also intermittent dull aching pain and edema in the left leg since 2 years, and hyperpigmentation and itching on the left leg for the past 1 year. And he also have a family history of varicose veins. So shall I proceed with the examination?
Meera?
Yes.
1 minute wait to go through the examination regarding your history. Rajshekar, hello?
Hello, sir.
Wait for 1 minute. We'll go through the history. I want to discuss the examinations. Wait.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Examinations?
Yes, sir.
Rajshekar?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Want to comment on your history?
No, I wanted to ask Meera why she commented on abdominal pain, constipation, abdominal distension, all these things in the history, associated history. Yes, there. No history of abdominal distension, swelling, constipation. In what context are you asking this?
Meera? Sir, any pressure in the intra-abdominal or intrathoracic will be transmitted to the venous system, causing venous, which is a causative of venous hypertension.
Okay, so in that context, you are asking all this.
Yes, sir.
Okay, and how would trauma result in varicose veins?
I asked trauma to rule out DVT.
Okay.
And a DVT can lead to secondary chronic venous insufficiency.
Yes.
Dr. Meera.
Anything else?
Dr. Meera.
Yes, sir.
You rightly pointed out DVT as a cause of varicose vein. So in case and where you are suspecting a DVT, what question will you will include along with the history other than what you present? Mm-hmm. Your history is almost complete except very few things only which we can, for criticism purpose, we can ask. But then if you suspect a DVT leading to varicosity, what other question you are supposed to ask other than the one which you presented? If it's of a very short duration especially. This is
surgery.
Not in relation to this particular T seller or T vendor, but then any patient of short duration, varicose vein or skin changes induced by varicose vein, having a very short history. In the history, what are the other, what is the other pertinent thing which you are? I suppose you have
mentioned that
being a chronic case in this long duration. He has mentioned that.
I think she has mentioned it, sir.
She has mentioned that. What do you mean? You mean the history of?
Sorry, sir. It's not. I can't clearly hear.
No. The history of. Did you mention history of prolonged travel or air travel in case of another?
No. She's not mentioned that.
That is what I was about to point out. One should have asked if it is a short duration varicose vein with symptomatology, suggestive of a DVT, a history of travel, especially air travel, and the history is pointing out to the economy class syndrome.
Okay,
only prolonged immobilization she has mentioned, which can happen during travel.
I mean the economy class syndrome leading question to get excluded. That's all.
Okay, doctor, hello?
Yes, sir.
Anil Kumar? Hello, sir.
Anil Kumar?
Yes, sir.
Anil Kumar?
Yes, sir.
Doctor Anil Kumar?
Yes,
Anil
sir.
Kumar. Any comments regarding history?
Yes, sir. I am just curious about whether the family history, of course, which is quite significant in this case, but I am interested to know whether what sort of family history do you mean? I mean, is his father or some other family member affected? Or was the affected family member also T seller with prolonged standing and things like that? Was family history really relevant in this case?
Am I audible? Works as a mason.
He's audible.
I can hear it. Yes, sir. I can hear it, but in between there's some disturbance. But I got the question, sir.
You didn't get the question from Dr. Anil?
Sir, I got the question. The brother, younger
so
brother,
was,
he works as a mason.
Oh, your father was a mason.
Brother.
And
his younger brother.
Younger brother was a mason. So that's the family history. Or are there any other family members like mother, father, other first degree relatives getting affected?
No, sir. Only he mentioned only about his brother, sir.
Dr. Meera, what Dr. Anil meant is what were the family members, siblings, and uncle or father who is more pertinently to be evaluated as far as a varicose vein history is concerned? What it is interrelated? That I think that is what Dr. Anil was.
So usually it is the first degree relatives. If both the parents are affected, there is a chance for 90% in the children.
Okay. Doctor, I mean, when you come to the family history, usually it refers to childhood disease, childhood venous disease, which, of course, you have so many inherited venous disorders of which varicose veins may be a part of it. Like, for example, see the so-called KTW or Krippel Tinane Weber, which of course involves a congenital arteriovenous fistula and childhood. So that is the importance of family history. Whether there's most of them would probably present to you during the adolescence or late adulthood. But this thing can get run in families, the vascular, the arteriovenous disorders can run in families.
Yes, sir.
So the other one is usually, you know, it's acquired due to long standing. If one of your younger brothers, 57 years, Mason, stands for a long time and contracts his illness, should probably be passed off as acquired. It's not really, you know, in this family history.
Okay.
Okay, good.
Okay.
Yeah, okay.
Dr. Binney, John? Binney? Dr. Binney?
Am I audible, sir?
Yes, audible.
Yes,
am I audible, sir?
Yes,
audible. I don't think that's the connection here. Okay, Meera, I just want to ask you.
Not audible now.
I'm
not clear.
Hello?
You mean not clear? You mean?
Hello?
Dr. Binney, you are partly audible but partly disrupted.
Okay. Clear. There is something wrong. It is doing some hide and seek. Can you also proceed, please? I'll just try to rectify.
Okay. We will. Hello, Dr. Meera. I want to. Hello?
Yes, sir.
In the history of drug history, what do you ask?
Yes.
Drug and person is any significance? Did you mention specially personal history? What do you ask? Did you mention specifically?
Yes, sir. Yes. In the drug history, I will ask whether he have taken any long-term anticoagulants, which will give me a indication for previous DVT.
Okay.
Or whether he have taken any medication itself for his present condition of varicose veins, whether he have gone into a medical management.
Regarding the personal history, what you lost?
Whether he has any addictions, he's a smoker.
You mentioned a smoker history, smoking history.
No, he's not a smoker or alcoholic. He has no addiction, sir.
And in the history of surgery, you should mention in the history of surgery in the angle. Angle is fixed or not? How it is affect the varicose vein? How it prone in the history, any surgery in the angle joint?
Sorry, sir, I didn't get the question.
Any surgery in the history of them, you mentioned the history of surgery. Did you ask any history of surgery in the ankle joint? If it is so, what is the importance in the history of surgery in the ankle joint?
Ankle fixation.
What is the importance?
Sir, any surgeries in the ankle joint can in turn affect the venous system.
How it is affecting? Ankle fixation, how it is affects? Yes.
Ankylosis.
Not angular, it's angle fixation surgery by orthopedics. How it can prone to develop varicose vein after angle fixation?
Sir, after the angle fixation, the foot muscle pump will be affected.
Yes, foot pump muscle and the peripheral heart affected. Okay. I think you can go to your general examinations.
Okay, sir. Coming to the general examination, the patient was examined in a well-lit room after taking consent and in the presence of an attender. The patient was conscious and oriented, is moderately built and nourished with a BMI of 20.2 and an ECG score of 1, and his vitals were recorded as pulse rate 64 per minute, regular in rhythm, normal volume and character, and felt in all peripheral vessels. Blood pressure 130/80 millimeters of mercury measured in right arm supine position. Respiratory rate of 16 per minute, abdominal thoracic type, and at the time of examination, the patient was febrile. No pallor, icterus, cyanosis, clubbing, or generalized lymphadenopathy was noted. Coming to the local examination, the patient was examined in the standing position and was exposed from umbilicus to downwards, and both the legs were examined. The attitude of both the limbs were normal, and there was dilated tortuous veins, which were seen on the anterior and medial aspect of both the legs, extending from the dorsum of the foot along the medial aspect of the leg. And multiple hyperpigmented patches were present on the skin of ankle and foot region of left leg. Edema and scratch marks were present on the left leg. Saphena varix not present on both the legs. And there was no ulceration, erythema or scarring seen. No loss of hair, dryness of skin, brittle nails or muscle wasting. So this is the photo of the patient showing tortuous veins on the medial and anterior aspect of both the legs and pigmented patches on his left leg, lower part of his left leg. Coming to the palpation, there was no local rise of temperature or tenderness. No thickened veins were palpated. There was no thickening of skin, and pitting edema was present on the left leg. Brody-Tennelenberg test 1 gave a positive result on both the legs. A rapid filling was seen from above downwards, showing a saphenofemoral junction incongruence. And Brody-Tennelenberg test 2 was also done and was positive on both the legs. Gradual filling was seen from below upwards, suggesting a perforator incongruence. Multiple tourniquet tests gave a result of below knee and above ankle perforator incongruence in both the legs. Modified Perthes test was done and deep venous system was patent on both the legs. Morrissey's cuff impulse test positive on saphenofemoral junction on both legs. And while doing Fagan's test, depressions were felt in the deep fascia at the region of below knee and above ankle perforators on both the legs. Percussion, short stress was positive on both legs, and on auscultation, no murmurs were heard. Peripheral pulsations were felt bilaterally, and inguinal lymph nodes were not palpable bilaterally, and sensation of the both lower limbs were intact, and there was no visible deformity or restriction of the joint movements.
Having said that, Dr. Meera, I just want to brush up your testing acumen of the conventional classic clinical test. You know, what is the essential difference between the Trendelenburg's test 2 and Perthes test in its performance, in the conduct of the test?
Sir, in Trendelenburg test 2, the patient is made to lie in the supine position and the leg is elevated and milking is done to drain the blood from the veins. And below the saphenous junction, we apply a tourniquet and then the patient is asked to stand. And we can see gradual filling of the veins from below upwards if there is a perforator incompetence.
And in modified Perthes?
Sir, in modified Perthes, we will not empty the veins prior to the examination.
Yes,
the
patient got it. That is the only thing which I wanted to elicit. That is a different way. We will never empty when doing modified Perthes, whereas in the other one, we will empty the vein. You know it. Okay. Proceed, okay. Other examiners, if anything.
Coming to the...
So you can complete your examination. You can complete.
Okay, sir. Coming to the other system examination, per abdomen, on inspection, no dilated veins were visible, no visible mass or distension. On palpation, the abdomen was soft, no organomegaly or no palpable mass, and per rectal examination was normal, and external genitalia of the patient was also normal. Cardiovascular system, heart sounds were heard normally, no murmurs. Respiratory system, normal vascular breath sounds were heard bilaterally, and in central nervous system, no focal neurological deficits were appreciated. Coming to the summary, a 62-year-old male who is a T-seller by occupation with no known comorbidities came with complaints of dilated tortuous vein on bilateral legs since the past 5 years, with pain and edema and discoloration of the skin and pruritus on his left leg and with a family history of varicose vein. On examination, he was found to have saphenofemoral junction incompetence and below knee and above ankle perforator incompetence on both the legs.
Yes, Meera, I doubt your team maker or the seller?
Sir, he has
a tea seller and either other tea seller or tea maker.
Prime Minister was described as a tea vendor. No. So there is a difference between tea maker and tea vendor.
Sir, he has a small shop by the side of the road.
Yes, proceed.
So tea maker. Okay. Then hello. So you will go to now the examination. Hello, Rajasekhar. You start with Rajasekhar.
Yeah. Meera, in the picture, can you just put on the picture image again?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. He has on the medial aspect as well as the anterior aspect, right? I'm
yes,
not
sir.
Able to, yeah, on the right leg, that is the left leg, medial aspect. On the right leg, you're seeing the anterior vein, the anterior cutaneous vein. And
yes.
What about the medial and the lateral and the posterior aspect is what I had a doubt about.
Sir, there were dilated veins both on the anterior and medial aspect, but there was no veins on the posterior and lateral part.
If you find them, what would you suspect?
Sir, a short saphenous system incompetence.
Okay. So if there is a short saphenous incompetence, where would you or would you try to locate the saphenopopliteal junction?
Sir, the saphenopopliteal junction is usually variable. In 50% of the patient, it will be above the popliteal fossa. And in rest, it will be about 2 centimeters below the popliteal fossa.
How will you localize it?
Sir, clinically?
Yeah.
We can tie a...
We can tie a tourniquet or as part of the multiple tourniquet test, or maybe sometimes we may be able to feel a depression like by the Fagan technique. Fagan method, we may be able to feel a depression there at the site where the saphenopopliteal junction is located.
Okay.
Or if you are not able to clinically appreciate, you will have to ask your radiology colleagues to localize it and mark it for you. Because if there is
okay.
Saphenopopliteal junction incompetence, you would need to address that also when you do your operation. Most of the time during surgery, we localize it by Fagan technique. Fagan method, and we try to ligate in the popliteal fossa. But nowadays, most of the time, if there is a Doppler done, they would actually show us where it is and mark it for us. But I would still say that you familiarize yourself with the clinical assessment of a saphenopopliteal junction. Gobi, sir.
Okay.
And yes, Meera, I would like to ask also one more question.
I can't hear, sir.
Can you hear us?
Meera, am I audible? Hello, Meera.
Hello, Dr. Meera. Meera is not there.
Hello?
Hello, Meera, am I audible now?
Yes, yes, sir.
Okay, Meera, I would like to add to that question. What is vein of Guaiacomini?
Hello?
Is there any connection other than saphenopopliteal junction where you said it's highly variable? Sometimes this short saphenous termination may be replaced by another vein. Can you name it? You have heard about vein of Guaiacomini?
Yes, sir. Yes.
What is its relevance as far as this terminal point of small saphenous and that course of great saphenous is concerned?
Yes, sir. It connects the great saphenous and the short saphenous vein.
What is the location of vein of Guaiacomini? It's ebony or it is in the lower thigh? It's in the lower thigh or in the knee or in the popliteal fossa?
Meera, you cannot use other accessory gadgets to answer questions.
No, sir, I'm not getting connection. Something is wrong with my connection, sir.
Okay.
Answer
my question. Where is the vein of Guaiacomini if it is situated or it is present? Is it above the knee or it is in the popliteal fossa or below the knee?
Sir, it is above the knee.
Okay. Proceed.
What is the relation between this short saphenous system and Guaiacomini vein? What is the relation? Short saphenous system and
it is usually seen as a continuation, upward continuation of the short saphenous vein.
Okay. And where will it be empty?
Sir, it will be emptying into the great saphenous.
Okay, ultimately to the great saphenous vein. Okay, very good. Now, regarding the tests, you said almost all the tests. I think you have mentioned Trendelenburg Schwartz test and those things you haven't mentioned, it seems. Or did you mention that along with the list?
Yes, sir. I have mentioned.
What is the relevance of Schwartz test over the other tests in case of a gross? Can you apply Schwartz test or the Schwartz test must inevitably be done in all cases of varicose vein examination? Now, the latest, you all know clinical tests are almost becoming obsolete, but then still we have to know that as postgraduates and UG, as a clinical test where Doppler is not available. So, are you expected to do Schwartz test in all cases or in selective cases only?
Sir, we usually don't do it for all the cases. Only when we think of a saphenofemoral incompetence, junction incompetence.
No, that is not the answer.
No, that's not the answer. You have clearly mentioned in percussion that you've done Schwartz test, no? Just describe what you did.
Sir, I palpated the vein from below with my left hand. And I could feel a thrill on the proximal part.
Okay, you could get a thrill or you are thrilled when percussing lower down in the...
With
the eliciting finger. With the eliciting finger kept. In what scenario you will get? It is not a hallmark of saphenofemoral junctional incompetency. So it should be looked upon only in selected cases. What is that scenario where you are inevitably supposed to look at the Schwartz test other than the other test? It is in a long-standing, very tortuous, dilated vein only. This test will be expectedly positive. That's the thing point which I want to stress. Proceed.
Now go to Binny. Binny is ready or not? Binny?
Binny is... Dr. Binita?
Binny?
Am I audible now?
Yes,
Meera?
Yes, sir.
Hello, Meera?
Yes, sir.
When you inspect the patient, did you look at the genitalia and the pubic area as well as the lower abdomen?
Yes, sir.
So why did you look this region?
Sir, to rule out other varicosities.
What varicosities?
Sir, other scrotal varicocele or in perirectal examination, whether there is any hemorrhoids. Oh. And the lower part of the abdomen to rule out any inferior velencaval obstruction, any portovenous anastomosis. Okay.
Suppose, Meera, if you... Okay, but Binny, proceed, please.
Inferior vena cava obstruction, what is?
Hello?
The question was in inferior vena cava obstruction. Binny John, sir's question.
How, sir?
IVC obstruction.
So in IVC obstruction, we can see lateral dilated veins on the lateral side of the abdomen wall.
Right.
So if you see dilated veins over the suprapubic area, what is your inference? Not on the lateral aspect.
Maybe a pelvic vein congestion.
Very good, very good. Okay, proceed. Pelvic vein congestion or obstruction due to other...
So, intrapelvic malignancies.
Evidence. So, dilated veins in the lower abdomen is a direct evidence of a deep vein obstruction. It can be a pelvic vein, that is iliac vein, or an inferior vena cava. So, that will tell you that there is something wrong. Then you have to test the direction of flow.
Yes, sir.
So, if it is from below up, it's from below upwards, that means it is draining to the axillary vein. Right.
Yes.
In a bypass route.
Yes.
Right. Okay.
Dr. Anil Kumar, anything you want
to
ask?
Yes, sir. I just want to go back to your tests. I mean, the slides on tests. Per this Fagan. Fagan test you have mentioned. Fagan, it's in fact, Fagan's method of examination, as Dr. Rajesh rightly mentioned. It's a method of examination, and I'm not convinced with your Fagans. Fagans, if you really go into the Fagans in the chronic venous insufficiency like this, you'd sooner or later find out various areas in the defacia which are deficient, which you'd be able to mark out. In the pre sort of Doppler era, we used to go by this method. This method is a revelation for most of us during our pre-ultrasound era. So I just want you to revise your slide on Fagan. And of course, I was also a little skeptical about the position of that limb, of the left limb that you have photographed in the sitting posture. I mean, what exactly do you mean by a sitting posture? Either you make him lie down or in the supine or in the erect posture. Otherwise, you know, there is no role for a sitting posture. That does not convey any additional means. You should have taken a photograph in the supine with the leg up and see what happens. And in fact, inspection would show you a blowout in the region of the inferior, I mean, just below the knee joint. That's a blowout that is seen there. I think so, but I don't recall the exact photograph. So that's why I thought I saw a venous blowout there in the region of the below knee perforator. And of course, these are some of the, and you have mentioned no murmurs. I mean, for your information, the murmurs are usually heard over precordium, and what we listen to is artificial bruit.
Bruit.
Murmur, of course, you come along with a CVS examination. This is a bruit that we see. Then, of course, in all the cases, make it a point to do a peripheral nerve examination also, just to, for completion's sake, make sure that, of course, especially when a patient has undergone a previous surgery where you expect the saphenous nerve to be injured or something like that. Or, in fact, varicose, one of the etiological factors of varicose veins is due to chronic muscular hypoactivity. So yes. These patients stand for a long time without actually getting the muscles exercised. So ultimately, there may be an element of a peripheral neuropathy or something like that with, we may associate it. Or then muscular hypotonia. In fact, the sort of the osteofascial muscular compartment is not properly toned, so that the peripheral pump is not working. So that you may have to focus on educating the patients to do that. And that can also, muscular hypotonia can also come out with some predisposition to varicose veins.
Well, in fact, Mira, in fact, you have to examine the arteries, veins, lymphatics, skin and subcutaneous and joint. I think you have mentioned all the examination. So, and I want to know, how will you exactly do a perthesis? Modified perthesis, not perthesis. How will you?
In perthesis, the patient is asked to stand and we will apply a tourniquet at the saphenous, below the saphenous junction, and we'll ask the patient to walk for 5 minutes. And there will be, if the deep venous system is patent, there will be shrinkage of the varicosities. And in case of a deep venous thrombosis, the venous system, the superficial veins will become more prominent.
Okay, correct.
Meera, yes, also, you said because of the test, you could locate the perforator in government. Can you just enumerate the perforators for a briefing?
So for the Greig saphenous system, we have the Hunterian perforator at the upper part. Then DOTS, which is the thigh perforator, BOLTS, which is the knee perforator, COCKETS, the above angle perforators, and May and Kushner's, the angle perforators.
BOID is not only the knee perforator, above knee perforator. Below knee, what is it? Sorry, BOID is the below knee perforator.
BOLTS is the below knee perforator.
Above knee, what is the name?
DOTS.
She mentioned. What is the perforator near the angle? You mentioned?
Sir, May and Kushner's.
Above the malleolus? Above the malleolus?
Above the malleolus. Pockets?
How many perforators? How many pocket perforators?
three perforators are there at the length of 5 centimeters, 10 centimeters, and 15 centimeters.
Okay. What are the perforators or shorts of the system?
So the one main one is Basie's perforator, which is a calcaneal perforator, and then there is a soleal point perforator and a gastrocnemius point perforator.
Okay, correct.
Main named ones.
Very good. Okay.
Meera, how did you do the tourniquet test? Can you describe the tourniquet test, multiple tourniquet test?
Then multiple tourniquet test, patient to lie down and elevated the limb and did milking to hasten the drainage of the blood. And multiple tourniquets were applied, one over the, below the saphenous junction, one at the just above the knee joint, and other one below the knee joint, and one above the ankle. And then the patient was asked to stand, and the tourniquets were removed from below upwards. And we could see the filling of the veins at a particular point, which showed perforator incompetence at that area.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then,
actually, you have to observe for the segments which are filled before untying the tube.
Okay, sir.
Okay. The segment get filled, that means there's an incompetent perforator.
Yes. Okay. Yes, sir.
Then you start moving from below upwards. Then you know that the cause of varicosity in one segment is due to an incompetent perforator above. Okay, sometimes between two segments, the vein may be collapsed. When you remove the tourniquet above that, suddenly the vein starts filling. That means the reflex is from above. That is the inference.
Meera, instead of, I think, better to mention three tourniquet tests or five tourniquets, then multiple tourniquets. What is three tourniquet tests? And what is the name of three tourniquet tests?
In three tourniquet tests, the one tourniquet is applied below the saphenous junction.
Second.
And one just below, above the knee.
Third one.
Below knee.
What is the name of that test? Name of somebody?
Not sure.
This is Mahoney's test. And what is Oskiner's test? That is three tourniquet test. Other is a five tourniquet test.
You
can also do multiple. These are usually you are doing a three tourniquet or five tourniquet test. Nowadays, as a PG student, you should know, because now Doppler is there, the significance are reduced. Even then, a PG student should know what is three tourniquet test, what is five tourniquet and multiple tourniquet. And you can confirm whether your Doppler person is done is correct or not. You also can verify by the tourniquet. Still, there are some role in the tourniquet test, I think so. Okay, other examiners.
Meera, we have touched superficially about the superficial vein and the perforase. Can you just name the deep system also from the leg to the thigh? How many deep veins are there in the leg?
So femoral vein.
The leg, I am asking.
Starting from the lower.
Okay, sir. We have two plantar veins, which combine to form the posterior tibial, and then there is an anterior tibial vein and peroneal vein, which will join to form the popliteal vein. And
is it single or double? Like usually you get
paired. They are usually paired.
Paired three axial veins in the leg. That is answer.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Okay, then
Meera, okay, once more, hello, Meera.
Yes, sir.
How popliteal vein is formed?
Popliteal vein is formed by the fusion the posterior tibial vein and the anterior tibial vein will drain into the popliteal vein, sir. It will continue as the popliteal vein.
That is not exact. That's three pairs. That's anterior tibial, posterior tibial, peroneal.
Peroneal also,
two more branches, gastrocnemius and soleus
branches. Gastrocnemius and soleus branches are also
these all together form the popliteal veins.
Okay. They form the soleal venous plexus, sir. it forms the plexus of veins inside the soleus muscle, and then they then the soleal venous plexus then drains into the popliteal vein after so many muscular branches of the deep system. So,
so they are sinusoids.
Soleal venous plexus. That should be the answer. Yes. That forms the popliteal vein.
Okay, sir.
And then after popliteal, what happens? Just complete it.
It will continue upwards as the femoral vein.
Which femoral vein? Need not have too much questions. You can name it and complete it.
Sir, continue asking. Superficial femoral vein, which gets and the profunda femoris vein will join together to form the common femoral vein.
Where is the common vein, femoral veins beginning? Where is superficial and deep joining?
At the level of Hunterian.
No. Hunterian canal, it is named as superficial femoral vein only.
Superficial femoral.
What is the site described where you are having deep and superficial joining together to form the common femoral? Commonest incidence, I am asking. Not about variations. At the level of inguinal ligament, that is what is happening. Then from there onwards, it is named as a common femoral underneath, and then it becomes the external iliac.
External iliac.
Of which are all the valved veins? These are all very important for the PG, that's why I'm asking. Now we cannot sculpt that and go to the clinical scenario.
Sir, all the distal veins have valves in them. Except for the sinusoidal veins.
Sinusoidal, it is only pouches, out pouches, like Japan Gudiwala, you know, you're having wells in between to reduce the pressure and to have the reservoir pumping in between. But then, distally, you are getting veins more or proximally you are getting veins more?
Distally, the valves are more, sir.
So how many valves are there in leg veins? Usually, approximate number, you can just make a guesswork. It will be less than 10 or less than 5, or it will be more than 10 or around 10.
Sir, it is more than 10.
More than 10. Okay. Then as you come to the, how much you maximum target limit in statistics, how much up to how much?
Sir, there are about 12 to.
Up to 13 is 30, that average.
Okay. Average is saying that 12 to 18 valves in the long saphenous,
yes,
and yes. 8 to 10 in the short saphenous. Am I correct?
Yes, yes.
Total
sir.
Number. But we are asking about the below knee perforator, it is even described as up to 13. And then you have up to 2 to 5 in the popliteal, and you have 2 to 4 in the superficial femoral. In the common femoral, you get hardly one, especially in less than 50%. That is a statistic. Now you go ahead. Are you having a similar system in upper limb? Why we are not getting varicosity in upper limb? Are you having a superficial and deep system in the upper limb also? Or we are having only superficial system?
No, sir. Even the upper limb, we have a superficial and deep system. The superficial
what is the deep
system?
Vein of the upper limb? What is the deep vein of the upper limb?
So the radial and the ulnar vein joining to form the axillary vein.
There is no vein named as radial and ulnar vein. There is some named branches in upper limb. What are the name? What is the name of upper limb veins, main veins? This is how you cannot prevent such questions. You know, in the upper limb, what are the veins named veins? What are superficial? What are
superficial
deep?
System consists of cephalic and basilic vein.
That's how you should answer. So cephalic and the
basilic vein.
Basilic, which is medial, which is lateral?
So cephalic is lateral and basilic is medial.
You mean lateral means you mean radial. Radial position is actually cephalic, isn't it?
Cephalic.
And basilic is medial, isn't it? What is the continuation to be named as axillary? Is it cephalic or basilic, continuing as the axillary vein?
So the cephalic?
No.
No, sir. The basilic vein along with the deep vein joins to form, drains into, it continues as the axillary vein.
What is the deep vein? Answer my question. What is the deep vein of the upper limb? Is there any named vein as the deep vein of the upper limb? Like the tibial, peroneal, anterior tibial, posterior tibial, peroneal, we said vena combitans are there. Like that, at least there will be some vein. What is the vein? Can you name it now? I am giving a hint. It is, I agree, it is vena combitans. Vena combitans to which artery?
Brachial.
Vena combitans of the brachial artery. So the point to be stressed is only deep system in upper limb is in the arm, not in the forearm. Okay. That is the thing. That is the thing to be stressed. Okay, proceed.
Okay.
Brother, I want to ask one question. What is the Da Vinci's tree? Da Vinci's tree. You are not Da Vinci's tree. Da Vinci's. You are not a tree.
Leonardo da Vinci.
Yes. What is Da Vinci's tree?
Yes, sir. The posterior arch vein of posterior arch vein, which is a tributary of the great saphenous vein. It is usually referred to
as... It is starting from where? This vein is starting? Related to the medial malleolus?
Behind the medial malleolus, sir.
Behind one joint to the great saphenous. What is the significance? What is the surgical significance of this vein?
So usually, this is the vein which becomes varicose. And it has got... usually, the perforators are joined to the posterior... towards the Leonardo vein, posterior
vein. Sometimes only varicose vein, only this vein, not in the great saphenous vein. And the importance of there is a subfacial ligation, that is dots operation. It's very important veins, this avenues. Okay. Binny is there?
Okay.
Binny, I think it is time to start the investigations. Binny? We need some problem. Anil Kumar?
Sir.
Dr. Anil Kumar?
It's true, sir. Now we'll proceed to investigation.
Yes. Now is the time to start management.
So first, for this patient, I will start with the routine blood examinations. And we'll proceed with the venous duplex system. Venous duplex examination.
What is the relevance of routine blood examination in a case of venous disease?
So, for this patient, I would like to rule out
only
all
for,
the...
Only for fitness or some specific reason is there. We do that for a fitness for any operation, but routine blood exam, is it having any relevance to venous disease? Any condition, hemorrhagic condition, which may manifest as deep vein thrombosis?
Sir, hypercoagulability states.
Hypercoagulability
states.
At least you need to check that the total lipid profile, those things. And I am asking about routine blood CBC, DC, what way it will guide us to an etiological factor of DVT. Which factor of the CBC? Any condition where you get DVT?
Polycythemia.
That
polycythemia.
Is that is what I just want. Okay, proceed. Continue your Doppler.
Please continue.
I will do a venous duplex scan on both the legs.
Yes.
And I will also do a USG abdomen to rule out any intrapelvic.
Meera, what is duplex scan? Can you elaborate? What it is?
Yes, sir. It is a B-mode ultrasound paired with a Doppler study. And in this, the main main factors which we look for is it will confirm which superficial system is involved. And it will also give us an idea about the perforator incompetence and also about the deep venous system, patency of the deep venous system. And before surgery, we can also assess the size of the vein. That is the caliber of the vein and the extent of reflex.
How will you assess the patency of the deep system? You said patency of deep system can be assessed. What is the keen observation which will give you an idea that deep veins are patent without any obstruction?
Sir, while doing Doppler, usually the deep veins will compress on applying pressure. In case of an thrombosis, there will not be any compression for the deep veins. Compressible.
Any other thing?
The venous flow will be obstructed.
No, are you not bothered about the continuation of the venous system? If there is a pelvic block or an inferior vena cava block, how will you know? What is the inference you will get in V mode Doppler?
So usually, Doppler.
You will be having an observation as a surgeon. Some days we are called upon probably to do a Doppler in future if you are going to concentrate on vascular. So what will you observe with the respiration?
There will not be any phasic change.
There should be phasic variation observed. Phasic variation of flow of the deep system should be observed to make sure that the deep vein is patent up to its drainage into the right atrium. Yes.
Okay, sir.
What is the frequency used the source of the veins, ultrasound frequency?
That's 7.5 to 13 megahertz.
Okay, correct.
Mira, on the Doppler, duplet Doppler, is there anything pertinent to the saphenofemoral junction that information that you may get?
So we will get an idea about the size of the saphenous vein, saphenofemoral junction, and the reflex at that point.
Yeah.
And it is
the reversal of flow, return of flow.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. And are they able to grade it? Some radiologists do grade that. Saphenofemoral junction incompetence, they do grade that also.
So usually a normal reflex in the superficial system is less than 0.5 seconds. If it is more than 0.5 seconds, it shows a incompetence.
In the deep system?
In the deep system, it should be more. If it is more than 1 second, then there is insufficiency, incompetence. And for the perforators, if it is more than 300 milliseconds, more than 3.3 seconds.
So perforator 300 milliseconds, superficial 500 milliseconds, and deep system 1 second. That is.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Is there any size for an incompetent perforator which is significant?
Yes, sir. Usually, if it is more than 3.5 millimeters, perforator can be incompetent.
3.5 millimeter and reflex more than 300
milliseconds. And in case. Okay, sir.
Why are you doing a duplex ultrasound for veins? Right? You will evaluate deep vein, you will evaluate superficial veins and perforators.
Yes, sir.
And also mark perforators.
Yes.
Will you have any other main points in your mind to be done at the time of duplex ultrasound?
So we can also mark the other relevant veins, which may be points of reflex, like the vein of Gyakumini.
Okay, excellent.
And also the other tributaries, other tributaries of the great saphenous vein can also be visualized, like the posterior arch vein of Leonardo. Whether there is any venosities in it.
Then, accessory saphenous.
Accessory of the accessory.
So-called duplication, anterolateral thymine, terminate as a duplicated vein at the close to the saphenofemoral junction. You may miss it. If it is there, that you have to note.
Okay.
And the axial veins, lateral axial vein, in some of the congenital anomalies, there, you have to knot.
Yes.
And the termination of short saphenous vein has to be exactly marked.
Okay.
Then all back to brachial index, pressure index, while you do a duplex ultrasound, because if there is a vascular insufficiency that may be significant with respect to treatment of the varicose veins.
Yes, okay, sir.
Meera,
yes.
if there is a varicosity affecting one limb alone, which limb is more vulnerable? Right or left?
Left side, sir.
Can you tell me the anatomical reason?
In the left side, the iliac vein has a straighted course.
Yeah. Reaching the answer, yes. Left side iliac vein is straight or something else?
Compressed by something else.
What is May Turner syndrome? The left iliac vein is compressed by the right iliac artery.
Between right common iliac artery and the vertebral cord. There is a compression. Other than that, do you get any other reason to explain all those anomalies? You know, we have five branches or six branches at the septa junction, having anterior lateral and posterior medial accessory veins, etc. How come an embryological basis can explain this? Why that much anomaly is there described along with venous system and when compared to arterial? I will give a hint also. Can you give some embryological explanation? I will guide you to an answer with some more hints. This is explained by anomalous incidence in the abdomen of the venous system. If you answer this, I'll be more than happy.
Please continue, sir. I'm also waiting for the answer.
Because during
the embryonic period, embryonic life between 6 to 10 weeks, our inferior vena cava is developing from 5 transverse channels of veins. They are named as supracardinal, subcardinal, anterior cardinal, posterior cardinal, and sacrocardinal components. They fuse together by obliteration of some part. That is how a vena cava is formed, and the vena cava will be usually lateral to the artery in normal position. Sometimes it can be retroaortic, or sometimes it can be circumaortic. Sometimes it can be on the left side even. And consistent with that anomaly of fusion, you will get consistent anomaly of the lower limbs also. That is the embryological explanation. And you may get for the cardiac surgeon, for the vascular surgeon, inadvertently, if they are clamping an abdominal aorta, one may come across ligation or bleeding from actually retroaortic or a circumaortic left renal vein. And if the vascular surgeon is not very keen about it. So these are all explained by the embryological basis of 5 cardinal veins, subcardinal, supracardinal, which I mentioned, fusing together in the normal way, preventing from, if there is aberration of that, that will be reflecting in the venous anomaly. Yes, proceed, please.
Thank you, sir.
Then after Doppler and Doppler scan, then how will you proceed?
So for this patient, I will start with the conservative management techniques. And according to the Doppler study, we'll also give him options for other interventions.
What are the conservation?
Especially on his left leg. Conservative procedures include, first is the graded compression stockings.
He is using it from last 3 years, you said.
Yes, sir. He's not compliant with it. So I can move on to other compression methods, using other compression methods like Una boots or four-layer dressing.
Is there any ulcer?
No, sir, no
ulceration.
Then why four-layer?
Only hypopigmentation.
Yes. Meera, what is compression dressing? Compression bandage, or you mean compression bandage or compression dressing?
Sir, graded compression stockings.
What is a grade and what are the types of grades available?
So in the British classification, grade 1, when the pressure is between 14 and 17 mmHg.
That is grade.
Grade 2, when it is between 18 to 24. And grade 3, when it is between 25 to 35.
That is, yeah. So you will choose that depending upon the clinical manifestation and the Doppler findings, whether we should apply there. Some authority even say that for an ulcer to heal, you need to have, for example, our own, evaluator team, Dr. Bhavsar's textbook, it is rightly quoted. Sometimes it may be the pressure required, maybe even more than 35 to 50 even for the venous pressure to be combat. So you need to choose this depending upon the clinical scenario as well as the Doppler findings. The grade of it and the pressure points. Sorry, the basic variations.
Yes. Meera, before compression management, any other exams you'll do to assess? Any other vascular system you want to assess before compression? Any compression?
So the arterial system.
What is the age of the patient?
62, sir.
Age is 75 something. So
62.
So how will you assess? What is the contraindication of this compression? Oh, sorry.
So if there is any arterial insufficiency, it will.
How will you know? What is the how much?
The angle. I can do the angle brachial pressure index, calculate the angle brachial pressure, or can do an arterial Doppler.
ABL less than how much?
0.7, sir.
This 0.5. And the angle 0.5. Pressure is less than 60 millimeter. This is contraindication for compression.
Okay, sir. Okay.
So you're planning conservative management. Yes.
When you plan the treatment, before that there is something named as primary varicosity, secondary varicosity. We just want to class it whether it is a treatable secondary varicosity or not. So what are the clinical manifestation of secondary varicosity other than this? Suppose if you suspect an arteriovenous fistula, etc. Clinically, can you suspect arteriovenous fistula other than a Bruy, other than a palpable thrill? What is other feature in the clinical manifestation?
So in case of arteriovenous malformation, there will be hypertrophy of that particular limb.
What do we call that actually? What is the term for that?
Gigantism?
Local gigantism.
Local gigantism.
If you get local gigantism, what do you suspect? You suspect an arteriovenous
malformation.
Other than that, in a young individual, if you get a local gigantism, what is the answer? Other than arteriovenous fistula?
The lymphatic.
No, that I'm asking about the venous anomalies associated with the manifestation of varicosity as a triad.
It could be a Klippel-Trenaury syndrome.
That is already mentioned. So these are the scenario where you get varicose vein associated with local gigantism. One is arteriovenous fistula, second is Klippel-Trenaury. So there you should look for. What is the other third component of Klippel-Trenaury? How will you suspect Klippel-Trenaury?
Klippel-Trenaury syndrome is a clinical triad which affects the vein lymphatic system in the form of hemangiomas or nevus. And there is hypertrophy.
Proceed. And secondary arteriovenous fistula, what are the common surgeries which you will ask for where there can be a chance of AV fistula created by as iatrogenic AV fistula other than dialysis? Any surgery which is vulnerable to produce it in the previous time, at least now they are very keen about that. What colleague of us, which system of colleague who are actually having that surgery, and which surgery is more vulnerable to manifest as IV fistula?
Orthopedic.
Which orthopedic? You are right. Which orthopedic? Which part of orthopedic surgery? Spinal or long axial? This is not very prevalent now because now open laminectomy, etc. is now becoming obsolete. At that time, there were AV fistula formation chance with varicosities and lower down manifestation. Yes, proceed.
Okay.
Hello, Meera, how will you clinically classify this? What system and what is your classification? Is it primary or secondary, your case?
The primary case.
And what is the classification?
It's a CEAP classification.
Now, accordingly, what is this? Yes.
Sir?
With this, according to the CEAP classification, what is this case, your case?
You can class it as CEAP. CEAP subclassification, that is what Sari is asking.
Yes. Sir, in the left leg, it is C4A. EP, ASP, and PR. And in the right leg, it is C2, EP, ASP, PR.
Yes. Binny, I think Binny has no connection. Binny has no connection. Anil Kumar?
There is some problem connection here. Am I audible now?
But some problem is your voice.
Yeah, with the clarity, there is some problem beneath it. Some part is clear, some part is not clear. That is a problem.
Okay, proceed.
Okay, Dr. Anil Kumar, you want to ask something regarding the investigations over management?
Did you mention all the investigations in all cases? And you have mentioned Doppler rightly, that is the running investigation. This media Doppler. Any other investigation which may be mandatory or may be necessary in some cases, at least where you are not having the lesion here in the leg alone, you want to see higher up, what are the other investigations which should be looked upon?
So one is USG abdomen, and then we can proceed with an MR venogram to look at the iliac vessels.
MR is expensive, CT also is expensive. How will you choose between CT and MR?
Sir, usually MR venogram is done to assess the in iliac vessels. It will be more clear.
For iliac vessels assessment, MR angiogram is preferable or superior over CT. Otherwise, CT will do for as far as the proximal part of intervene cover those things are concerned. But rarely used in case of lower limb varicosity other than due to other underlying causes like secondary to be excluded or pelvic congestion syndrome, etc., to be excluded, we may have to resort to MR angiogram. Yes.
Okay. After your investigation and your diagnosis, primary varicose, how will you manage? The patient is not willing, not satisfied with your conservative management. How will you manage?
So I can proceed with the surgical. I can give him option for surgical or other ablative procedures.
What is your choice? You will opt for priority. Your priority as a doctor, as a surgeon, is now for open surgery or for interventional procedures, surgical intervention procedures.
So that will depend upon the duplex report. Yes.
Okay. Very good. Can you elaborate?
Sir, if the size of the vein of the superficial saphenofemoral junction is more than 1 centimeter, then more than 15 millimeters, it is better to opt surgical procedure.
That is conventional since long time, but New Bailey is not agreeing with the New Bailey doesn't mark. If Binny is audible, probably he would have answered it much more being a vascular surgeon. Now, New Bailey is not giving any criteria as per BMO to class this between as open surgery and those things. They are just telling this is actually novel technique to be adopted universally because of cost effectiveness, especially of the RFA and the newer technique that we are going to come to the detailed evaluation.
As a surgeon, surgery also equally good technique.
Yes,
very good technique.
Yes, sir. Good technique. Definitely, I agree with that. But then most of our patients are after most of the some patient choice, those who can afford, if it's almost equivalent to that, some of them are just standing first at least as priority, non surgery.
So, we'll ask for surgery. What surgery will do for this? Your conventional surgery. What surgery will do?
Sir, Trendelenburg surgery. And with the combined with multiple perforator ligation.
Yes.
Trendelenburg surgery, multiple. What about a thigh segment?
Sir, in Trendelenburg surgery, we will first high flesh ligate the saphenofemoral junction.
Where will you put the incision? Trendelenburg.
A groin incision, which is lateral. And in lateral to the level of pubic tubercle, a groin.
Where is the groin? Exact groin incision. Where is the exact incision you put? Groin means.
What is the position of the leg before making the incision?
Yes.
The leg is in the external rotated position, with the knee joint slightly flexed.
Then where will put the incision? Exact place.
So it is usually put at the level, but lateral to the pubic tubercle, at the level of and lateral to pubic tubercle.
How many centimeters? Infra or lateral? Where is the this skin crease incision? Skin crease.
Then okay. Skin crease incision.
Skin crease incision. Yeah. And where is the? How do you know this saphenous palate opening? Saphenous femoral opening. Where is the? It is situated.
It is situated about 2.5 centimeters lateral and inferior to the pubic tubercle.
And so how many? Any other technique to assess the incision lateral and any other technique? You have to put the incision. What do you palpate before putting incision?
Yes, we'll palpate for the saphenous varix or the. No, sir. We will palpate for the femoral artery pulsations.
Prominent femoral artery. How will you assess the femoral artery pulsation? Where will you can you assess? Where will palpate the prominent femoral artery pulsation?
So, medial.
Where will excite? Where is medial point?
There's a junction between the anterior superior iliac spine and pubic symphysis.
That's correct. You palpate and put the along the skin carry incision. Then what do you do?
What is that what is that point, that midpoint between the anterior superior iliac spine and pubic symphysis? You can rightly say the name of that. What is that? Is it mid-inguinal point or midpoint of inguinal?
Mid-inguinal point, sir.
The artery is running along mid-inguinal point. Very good. Okay. So you palpate the femoral artery at the mid-inguinal point and you'll make the incision so as to have a little lateral to that at the pubic tubercle. That's what you mean. At the highest point of the crease of the thigh and close to the groin. That is the answer. Okay.
What is the fascia there?
Cribriform fascia.
Over the vein, what is the fascia?
Brown.
What is the name of the superficial fascia of the thigh?
Superficial fascia. Name of the superficial fascia.
Yes, correct. You mentioned. Loudly. Loudly you can say.
Scarpa fascia.
So you ligated all the tributaries. Then what you'll do?
What are the tributaries? I think she didn't answer. The tributaries.
She can now answer. Yes.
What are the tributaries?
The name tributaries are superficial, inferior, epigastric,
medial tributaries and lateral tributaries. How many are there? Medial and lateral.
Sir, laterally, two tributaries are present.
Name it.
The superficial circumflex iliac vein.
Yes.
And superficial external proctal vein. It is medially. Superficial inferior epigastric vein.
Very good. Medially,
and
you get.
Medially, we have superficial external proctal vein and deep external proctal vein, and
then
accessory saphenous veins, and the posterior medial vein of thigh.
You have completed it. Very good.
Excited. And where will divide the vein? Exactly how many? Where will divide the long saphenous vein?
In earlier literature, it was said to be fresh ligation.
Earlier or not, what you will do for this patient? How will you put the suture there after division?
Fresh ligation of the saphenous vein is done after ligating all the tributaries.
What is the complication of this fresh ligation? We are putting a stitch there, microrotil. What is the complication? Putting the stitch there.
It can cause injury to the femoral vein.
Avulsion of vein. That is very dangerous.
Avulsion of the vein occurs. Yeah. Yes,
Any other? You are going close to the root of the vein. What is the
injury problem? Injury to the femoral vein.
Injury mentioned. Any other complication? Not injury. It can narrowing the vein by if we are close to the root of the vein, that can lead to the deep vein thrombosis.
Deep vein thrombosis can occur.
If the avulsion is occurred, what will do? What will happen? What will do if the patient develops avulsion? While doing surgery, then what will do? How will you manage? Avulsion and long saphenous vein with the femoral vein. How will you manage? You are and your assistant only in the theater.
Primary closure.
Tell me, this patient is bleeding. What do you do?
Primary closure.
Just in the bleed. In the bleeding, how can you see the vein? What do you do?
Sir, we'll apply compression to the low part.
Compression, how will you do it? During surgery, you will compress temporarily, but then what will you do?
You would need to apply, if you want to repair, you would need to have some length of vein on both sides, no, proximal and distal.
Okay.
So how would you achieve all that? Just applying compression.
Can you clamp it? Can you clamp it using some clamps?
Bulldog clamps can be applied.
If you apply bulldog clamp, any harm?
No, sir. They are usually non-traumatic.
So then what will you do?
Sir, you can answer.
You can seek the help if you want after controlling that. If you want, if the theater is having some vascular help, you can seek for a venous patch graft to be placed there. If that is not possible, then the vein you are doing superficial venous surgery, a patch can be trimmed and you can attempt to find proline air. Rather than keeping the vein narrowed to have permanent venous edema, you can attempt to do that if you are comfortable with this. So I think even general surgeons can do it.
Okay.
Now I just want to ask one more question. You know, too much is stressed about flesh ligation like that. What is the very purpose of flesh ligation?
So that the there will not be a back reflex in the residual great saphenous vein.
Also, what happens if there is a black reflex to the it remains as a cul-de-sac. So if there is reflux, it will not cause a recurrence unless there is a neovascularization between the branches ligated. You are ligating and separating it. It will not add to the ligation even if a stump is there. What is the next cause? What is the next harm anticipated?
Deep venous thrombosis?
The answer should be to prevent deep venous thrombosis, to prevent a blind cul-de-sac or vascular closed channel, side channeling. We just want to do a flesh ligation. That is answer.
So for thigh segment, what do you do after the surgery? Thigh segment, how do you manage?
Sir, we will do a retrograde stripping of the great saphenous vein, of the thigh segment of the great saphenous vein.
It is Trendelenburg plus stripping. What is the name of the surgery? In name?
Sir, Trendelenburg surgery.
Plus the stripping of veins. Any name for this? Not rich.
What is the stripper which you are using? Name it.
He stripped from the ankle region right up to the ephemeral region, which of course was not called for. Babcock's.
Yes.
Babcock's.
Yes. Okay. Right, together is called. So stripping, what are the methods of stripping available?
One is retrograde stripping and the other one is invaginating stripping.
Which is preferable? And what is the reason?
In inverting stripping, there is less damage to the surrounding tissue.
You are stripping below the knee, what is the complication?
Injury to the saphenous nerve will occur. And there will be intractable pain for the patient on the medial aspect of the leg. And
again, what is the very purpose of stripping of above knee even? What is the advantage of doing it? Stripping above knee at least.
By stripping the incompetent saphenous vein, we are providing, we are preventing the reflex which may later occur.
From where?
Okay. From there? Usually,
I prefer it, I agree. But then other than that, recurrence from the collaterals also is reported to be less with stripping. That is what people claim, Sundays are claiming.
So okay.
That will prevent two method of recurrence. Only, as you rightly said, from the deeper system reflexive further incompetency. Second is actually you may have neovascularization from the stump reaching, acquiring contact for collateral circulation if the stump is left. So some authority even just only trim the proximal part of the saphenous vein rather than stripping totally to prevent that.
Mira, what is surgery for the Cochlear perforatis? Name of the surgery. How will you manage? Surgically manage. How will you manage?
Subfacial endoscopic procedures of retrograde ligation.
As a surgeon, what you'll do? Yeah, that also available. You can do subfacial endoscopy. Correct. Any other type of surgery?
Sir, ambulatory named surgery.
Can you name that?
Famous surgeon named.
It's an authority in venous surgery. He has written a book on that venous surgery and venous system.
How will you manage this? That is already mentioned. Posterior arch vein. How will you manage? What is the name of the surgery?
The open subfacial ligation. Name it, please.
The common name. Every surgeon will ask usually in examination.
Meera, you are aware that there are two methods of disconnecting the leg perforatus. One is a major open fasciotomy surgery, isn't it? And second is micro fasciotomy surgery. Don't get deceived by the concept of subcutaneous vein ligation as the subfacial ligation. You have to have either microfasciotomy or a longitudinal fasciotomy. Now we are asking the name of the longitudinal fasciotomy to take care of all the perforators to be disconnected from the deep system.
Sir, Lipton flap?
Lindens
incision.
Lindens incision, sir. And if it is a horizontal incision, what is the instead of vertical, if you are putting a small horizontal, what is the name? Named after the perforators. Two names.
No.
You have some named perforators. again.
Dodd and Cockett operation.
Dodd and Cockett operation. Meera, the T is silent for you. We should also stress our PGs to learn good pronunciation. We never pronounce Chevrolet, but we pronounce it as Chevrolet. We know we pay certain T is silent. Like that here. Yes. Dodd and Cockett only, not Cockett.
Okay.
And Anil Kumar, sir, anything more you want to add the open surgery? Dr. Anil Kumar?
Please. Sir, my internet connection got a little problem.
But you are audible. The audibility is very clear. You can ask.
Clear. Am I audible? You are open surgery.
I have missed a large portion of the discussion, sir, including the treatment in the early part. I am sorry that my internet connection was not good. It got interrupted.
Okay. But now it is audible. Now you are audible.
Good discussion, sir. She is good with the theoretical aspects.
Okay. Discussion not complete. We only opened, sir. Now you are going to the modern techniques.
Sir, am I audible?
Binny, we discussed the open surgery, classical surgery. Now, other interventions, you can ask.
Open surgery, sir, one question. Meera, you have managed the Trendelenburg stripping up to the knee and perforator ligation. So, you are leaving a lot of tortuous dilated superficial veins there.
Yes.
Which is generally not acceptable to patients.
So we can do a phlebotomy.
Okay. Meera, what is the difference between phlebotomy and phlebectomy?
Sorry, sir. Phlebectomy.
It will be phlebectomy. That is phlebectomy in which we are resecting the vein. Yeah, otomy is only making a hole into it, right? It's the ectomy. It's a phlebectomy. As a PG, you should not have confusion. Yes.
Multiple stab vowels. Small incision, use a venous hook to pull it out, then you tease the entire length, whatever comes, tease the entire length of vein on both directions so that the superficial veins are taken away. So without that, patients are not going to be happy.
Yes, okay.
You can use some other newer methods, which we'll discuss later.
Okay.
Yes, you can start other options for this patient. If you're not willing to open surgery.
So we can proceed with the endovenous thermal ablation techniques, namely the endovenous laser therapy or the radiofrequency ablation.
Which is better, radiofrequency ablation or laser? RF or laser?
So radiofrequency ablation has got more recurrence rate.
RFA?
Has got more recurrence rate is more.
If you say that, the authority doing RFA will not agree because almost both of them are having equal, but there are some technical differences
between the Bailian will have given exact the certain points, advantage of RFA.
Advantage. Latest Bailey is giving a very good comparison of the advantages and disadvantages between these two and the provision of learning curve. Which is having more, which is having less.
And also,
it is stressing if you are a good PG, you should have learned Bailey and level latest section.
Sir, in case of radio frequency ablation, even though the machine is costlier, the learning curve is less.
What other advantage? Other advantage? RFA.
Now, before which, Meera, you need to have a basic concept about these two techniques of methodology. What is it? What is that the basic difference between laser rays and what is that basic difference in the radio frequency?
Sir, in radio frequency ablation, we are converting electromagnetic waves to thermal energy.
What is the temperature? What is the temperature usually attained at the coil at the tip of the radio frequency?
So 120 degrees Celsius.
Oh, this is 120 degrees centigrade. How many duration? What is the duration you only is permitted to apply at a stretch, a single beat by beat? How many?
Sir, 20 seconds.
20 seconds at a beat. Is it? Okay, very good. And for the other one, for the laser, what is the mode which you are using? Is it the metal mode, metal probe, or something else?
Sir, a glass, flexible glass probe is being used.
So that is, which is more costly, a laser unit? If you have a laser unit, the device is not very costly, I think, to my this thing. I think to this, Vinny will be answering much more better because he's a vascular interventional surgeon also about those things. But I think the unit, if you have a hospital is having a laser unit, the price cost factor is not that comparable. But there are certain advantages of radio frequency over laser. That is what Gobi sir is asking. Given in latest Bailey. There are two proponents also for even laser therapy to reach up to the flesh ligation comparative scenario. And there are certain proponents who are saying, no, please don't go up to the subfemoral junction, but keep away. Can you compare the pros and cons of these two methodology?
If the catheter is taken till the junction of the saphenofemoral junction. Till the saphenofemoral junction.
You are talking about laser technique, not about RF. No, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, in laser technique, there is more chance for vein wall penetration.
That is not the answer. Some centers are preferring to keep away from the saphenofemoral junction. Some centers are reaching up to the saphenofemoral. What is the pros and cons of this technique?
If we reach up to the femoral junction, one thing, there will be high chances for deep venous thrombosis in the femoral vein. And by doing a...
Yes. Hello? You can answer. Yeah, audible. You can answer.
The newer method which they adopt is high ligation.
This is the good sentence. Recurrence rate, actually, if you are not reaching to the saphenofemoral junction as in open surgery, is little more high. And those proponents of reaching the saphenofemoral junction say and claim that they don't have highest incidence of DVT, though said much. That's all.
Okay.
And learning curve is much, much less for RFA when compared.
And a special precaution for laser. RFA, no precaution required, no special precautions. Is that not? Hello?
Hello?
Yes, sir.
Precaution, sir, is asking.
Sir, in case of laser, we have to, tumescent anesthesia has to be given.
How will you prepare tumescent anesthesia? How will you prepare?
Combination of lignocaine, epinephrine.
Lignocaine?
Epinephrine and sodium bicarbonate. Diluted with crystalloid solutions like Ringer lactate.
You can even now use saline instead of sodium bicarbonate. But why is it called tumescent anesthesia? Why? What is tumescence?
To Ms. Smith, it will create a halo around the vein.
Halo?
Around the vein.
Is it halo or something else? The word tumescence was evolving out of the phenomenon of erection of vascular tissue. So it causes something like an expansive swelling around the perivenous plane. That creates an advantage, of course, because epinephrine is there, least vascularity in the perivenous plane. Second is, this will also protect the venous wall partly because of a cushioning effect by the mechanicals. Yes.
And the hydrodissection also.
Hydrodissection. Yes, hydrodissection also. That is all.
And it's a buffer zone for heat.
Yes, buffer zone.
Provides anesthesia and also prevent the burning of the surrounding tissues and also cause compression of the vein around the catheter.
Yes.
Like produce the cushioning effect.
Okay, proceed.
What about the pain and rest, etc. compared to open surgery and your RFA and laser?
Pain will be less in case of endothermal ablation techniques. And usually it is done as a daycare procedure. So the patient can return to normal work at an earlier phase.
Laser can also be done as a daycare surgery because some very good centers,
okay.
They can also be a daycare surgery. Yes. Mm-hmm. Any other endovenous ablation techniques, you know, other than these two? There are some latest advantage of avoiding tumescent technique.
Non-tumescent techniques.
Non-thermal NT technique is there. What is that?
Yes, sir. One is the endovenous glue, which
that
is being used.
That is only to obliterate using the glue.
Cyanoacrylate.
But this is having its own disadvantage sometimes. You know, but then it is on technique. Other than tumescent, non-tumescent, tumescent, can you name any other thing?
Foam sclerotherapy. USG guided foam sclerotherapy.
Foam sclerotherapy, yes.
Yes.
Yeah, actually USG guided foam sclerotherapy. What is the sclerosant which you use there?
Sodium tetradecyl sulfate.
Tetradecyl sulfate itself is in there. What is the role of sodium tetradecyl sulfate as far as foam sclerotherapy is concerned?
So it causes endothelial. It causes endothelial damage.
What is it chemically? Is it an acid? How does it cause damage? Is it an acid or an alkali or something else? Your answer should be, it's a detergent.
It's a detergent.
And that is why there are a lot of modifications of the technique. People say that minimum amount will be diluted by blood, etc. So there is some foam incorporated to have more volume contact with the endothelium, etc.
One more technique
is a MOCO technique, actually, mechanical-chemical technique.
Mechanical-chemical ablation.
That you haven't mentioned, that also should be. Because yes. It is the difference between MOCO and local infiltration is, MOCO can even utilize cannulation under ultrasound guide. There is no need of tumescent, we said. But yes. It can also be a continuous perfusion of guarded volume, rather than intermittent to particles. So no compression is required, no elevation of limb, no massaging is required, etc. That is.
Yes, sir.
What is the complication of your this foam therapy?
The complication of, sir?
Foam therapy.
There will be anaphylactic or allergic reaction to the sclerosant, and there will be chance of deep venous thrombosis.
Yes.
Ulcerations.
What is
Tessari
technique?
Tessari technique is the method by which the foam sclerotherapy is done. In two syringes, in one syringe we take sclerosant, and in the other we take air at the ratio of 1:4 or 1:3. And by
1:4 also correct. 1:3 or 1:4. Both are correct. Okay.
And by using a three-way cannula, we mix the two syringes. We mix the content of the two syringes to leading to the formation of a foam sclerosant. And hence a small volume. And this is injected into the vein using a catheter.
What is the recurrence rate after foam therapy?
So the recurrence rate is more like 16.5%.
16. Not 16. The guy, this guy.
Recurrence rate is.
It is 30 to 40%. 30 to 40% recurrence rate is.
Okay.
Yes. Yes, other Rajasekhar.
Yes, sir.
Meera, I would like to ask one or two more questions before now, before we wind up. Probably the others can also have questions to ask. But then you have, you know, certain questions faced generally on that. Why are we all that much bothered about the venous disorder? What is the economical status of developed countries? How many percentage of people are getting the venous disorder? And what is the resources utilized in more developed countries?
Sir, roughly about 40% of people are affected having venous disorders.
Approximately 40, but in some countries usually up to 25% only. But then, but even in a developed country like US, the resources are much. They say it is actually 2 billion per year spent for that. And in UK, it is approximately, even for bandaging and dressing of ulcers, even 2 to 3% of the health resources fund is being used. That is why we are concerned. And who is more affected, male or female?
Females are more affected, sir.
Again, going back to Babasar's textbook, it is almost nearly double as per sir quoted there. I know it is actually up to 15% in male incidence, whereas in female, it is up to 30 to 35%. That is the concern of us in most of it. Most of the healthcare expenses in the Western, especially in Caucasians, they're being utilized by the care of the varicose venous. So earlier detection is most important. Can I ask one or two intelligent additional questions? What is the, you know, venous claudication?
So venous claudication is type of bursting pain. And it is more when the, it is more after prolonged standing. And it gets relieved by elevating the leg or taking rest.
My answer respected is very specific. Can you describe what is venous claudication? Then only you can compare and tell clinically what it is.
Sir, it is a pain which occurs in a deep venous thrombosis. And it is characterized by?
No, sir.
Even in chronic venous insufficiency.
The claudication pain is seen at the onset of DVT or later on after some time?
Post-thrombotic, sir.
Post-thrombotic. So how will you explain claudication pain?
Venous claudication is characterized by a bursting type of pain.
Yes.
Which is more after prolonged standing or by the end of the day.
Yes.
And it gets relieved by elevating the leg or taking rest.
But it gets relieved by elevating rest. That is not the answer. What time, your time of onset, I agree, it is at evening, at the afternoon time onwards or at evening. But what is the reason? How will you distinguish between arterial claudication and venous claudication as far as symptomatology is concerned?
In arterial claudication, the pain will get relieved immediately. Answer is
only with a word, only with a word. So it's very easy. How we can clinically distinguish by the difference between arterial and venous. What is rest pain?
The pain occurs even at rest in case of arterial.
Will you get total relief immediately after walking or exercising in venous disease like arterial?
No, sir. It is gradual. And compared to arterial, it is gradual.
Yeah, that is the difference because the collaterals are attained out of long standing and central boring is boring. A boring happens in the thrombus. These are the alternate, but that is not sufficient enough to combat the venous. So you get pooling there, which will be relieved slowly only, unlike the arterial claudication. I will also ask one more question, which will be very interesting, which is very pertinent. I think because, you know, if you take the venous blood from the lower limb of an unilateral varicosity and a normal limb, what will be the saturation of the affected limb? Is it normal? Is it high or is it low? This is a very same question which I asked years back to my
UGC. In the ulcerated leg, what is the oxygen saturation?
This is still valid, this is still valid, and it is mentioned also in Bailey, but it is not standing high because that is not substantiated the reason is not substantiated. That is why it is still violent.
So usually there is hypoxia.
Tell me to my question. Is it high? Is it normal? Low. Or is it low in the affected limb?
It is
the ulcerated leg.
Low.
Is it high? Low. What?
I will add to that. There is also LDS, lipodermatosclerosis, is there in the limb.
So it will be low.
It will be low. You are sure? Venous blood of that limb is having less oxygen saturation than the opposite. No, that is the wrong answer.
No, sir.
You have only one chance. You have committed a wrong answer.
Wrong answer.
So it okay, should be sir, high. It should be high, and the reason also to be stressed, because before getting ulceration, you know that this LDS is there, fibrin is deposited, fibronectin is deposited, matrix, there is a lot of collagen tissue now. There is elastin destruction, etc. is being described. What happens is the tissues are not getting oxygen. The tissue cry for oxygen stimulates AV malformation proximally. Okay. This is what Bailey says, latest Bailey says, this is the reason, but nobody could yet substantiate demonstration of AV shunts proximal to that in this case, though the venous saturation is high. That is the latest
answer. Yes. Amira, I think you are going to end the side. Before concluding, I want to ask few questions. What is woody leg?
Seen in lipodermatosclerosis due to excessive fibrin deposition.
What is corona flavatitica?
Sir, corona flavatitica is a fan-shaped dilatation of the intradermal veins seen at the malleolus, near the malleolus.
Oh, that is telangiectasia. Is not
telangiectasia, fan-shaped telangiectasia.
Why is it called corona?
Fan-shaped
or crown
or like
what is atrophy blanking? These are clinical features. Atrophy blanking.
Yes. Atrophy blanking is a area of skin which is atrophic and white in color. It indicates severe chronic venous insufficiency, and it will be surrounded by telangiectasia and pigmentation.
And I will ask last question. One answer. One word answer. What is the cause for varicose ulcer?
Ambulatory venous hypertension, sir.
Very good. That's one way answer. I think any examiner can ask anything more. I think it's time for concluding.
I still want to ask one or two, but let the others ask and then I will ask, because you know.
Yes. Rajasekhar.
Sir, I suggest that we stop. Every possible question has been asked. Now we are searching for questions to ask Meera.
Okay.
She has answered most things. Correctly. I think we should appreciate that.
Certain important things also need to be stressed in this PG scenario, because I know Babasar's book again is classifying, as you said in Bailey also, the causes of varicosity is rightly classed inside the venous system as the wall causes and the valve causes. So can you enumerate what are the valve? We know whether it be agenesis, monocuspid, bicuspid, tricuspid, incompetency, then the divarication hole in the valve, repair, etc. All those are there, but this is beyond the scope.
Hello, concluding.
Let her tell that fact is leading onto the wall.
Okay. And I think no connection for Binny. It's out of connection. And Anil.
Now it
is audible.
Now audible.
I'll ask, no questions left. One question I'll ask, define varicose
vein. Okay.
So it is a dilated, tortuous subcutaneous vein, which is usually more than 3 millimeter in diameter when measured in the upright position, and should have a demonstrable reflex.
Meaning you satisfied?
Satisfied. But clinical or radiologically demonstrable reflex.
Yes.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Can you tell that also, the last part of my question's component? The fact is leading on to the pathology in the wall of the vein.
It can be.
I will start with inflammatory cells infiltration and its sequelae. Then there are 4 more factors. Can you mention? There is something decreased, something
As a production of mineralometalloproteins?
That is increased. Mineralometalloproteins are increased. What happens if matrix mineralometalloproteins are increased? That will be eating away the matrix. Yes. There will be
decrease in tissue inhibitor mineralloproteins.
Elastin is decreasing. That is very important. One more.
Yes.
There is a dysfunction of some more thing. What is that? Or can you? No. There is a dysfunction of the smooth muscle proliferation. Isn't it? Dysfunctional smooth proliferation. So these are the things to be stressed. Actually, the PG has to write this down. If a short note or an essay is asked. That is it.
Okay. Sir, now it's not concluded. We are going to our the Dayanubha sir. He is waiting there. Comments by our dear Dayanubha sir. Sir, welcome.
Meera.
Discussion is over.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, it was a good discussion. And I'm sorry that our authority, Bini, could not give much contribution to today's discussion. Anyway, I should thank Salim for quoting 3-4 times my name. Meera, what is this mixed diet? Anyway, you started
sir, he takes both vegetarian and non-vegetarian.
That's called non-vegetarian only. There's nothing, no mixing.
Yes, sir. Yes,
what is economy class syndrome, Meera?
The chance for DVT is more, while in case of air travelers.
Why?
They will be having prolonged immobilization and the pressure gradient will be more.
The pressure gradient. Sure. What is the peripheral heart called?
So the...
what is peripheral heart?
Calf muscle pump.
Calf muscle pump. And that is not functioning. What is e-thrombosis?
So which is usually seen in the... those working in the software field, like in offices where they will have to sit for a long period of time.
What is the minimum time required? Suppose somebody is lying down in the bed for development of DVT.
So if it is more than 3 days, according to us.
Yeah, more than 48 hours is enough. Okay. You mentioned rapid filling. What do you mean by rapid filling?
There is fast.
Fast means what? How much?
Less than 1 second.
Less than 30 seconds.
30 seconds.
What is Mickey Mouse sign?
So it is a sign which is seen in duplex study at the saphenofemoral junction. The femoral artery will be the lateral most, followed by femoral vein at the great saphenous vein. It will be in the form of a face of a Mickey Mouse.
I think Bini has gone, actually, the new CEAP, you have mentioned the CEAP staging, yes. But yes. There are some new current changes.
Yes, sir.
I thought Bini would elaborate on the new changes of CEAP. Just go through the modification of CEAP, which may help you in the examination. But I think otherwise, we are too late now, so I don't want to give more on the varicose vein examination. Anyway, it was a good presentation, and all the examiners were contributing nicely and under the leadership of E.V. Gobi. So I take this opportunity to thank all the examiners and Dr. E.V. Gobi. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Also, express my sincere gratitude to Dr. Rajasekaran from the Mangalore and Anil Kumar Alappuzha and Bini from Kottayam. And Dayanubha sir. And our HOD, Assistant Medical Dr. Mohammed Salim. And also our students, she presented well. Meera nicely presented the topic. And also other audience, students and other teachers. attending this program. Thank you very much. The next Sunday, same time, we'll meet again with another topic.
Congratulations, sir. I think you have presented well, reasonably well, with answering almost to the extent expected.
Thank you.
Having thank you, sir. Still, you have to read some more recent mail. As Bhav sir said, CAP, the latest change, etc. You have to refer once more.
Okay, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Bye-bye.